This video is sponsored by Bespoke Post.
In January of 2023, the western coast of the United States was hit with some really severe storms, one after another, and it has led to some pretty severe weather. For a state like California that's notoriously in drought, you think that'd be a good thing. But if you look around here, this is what happens when you have too much rain.
Typical mitigation strategy is to port the water and to get it into a storm drain and to get it out to the ocean, right? That's a quick fix. But the problem in San Diego is it's raining right now, but from March to November, we might not get another drop of rain.
We have heavy, heavy snowfall in the mountains, and there's even been loss of life and children missing. It's been a huge problem. And it got me thinking about something I saw about 7 years ago on a story about thirsty concrete, or concrete that could let water through to avoid things like this. But 7 years later, I've heard nothing about it. So what happened? Where's the thirsty concrete? If it was the answer to flooding, why aren't we using it? That's what we're talking about today. I'm Ricky, and this is Two Bit da Vinci. One of the main culprits for flooding is concrete, pavement, asphalt, and other impervious ground cover that doesn't let water soak back through. In fact, a study that I was just reading about recently says that for every 1% of the land you cover in an impervious cover like concrete, you increase the risk of flooding by 3.3%. So if you look at any major city, we've paved paradise and put up a parking lot. And that has some major ramifications because, like everything else in science and engineering, water management is a question of equilibrium. So we have water that we use all summer, and we have evaporation from the sun hitting the earth and plants and trees and roots, and we have a system. And then in the winter when the rains come, that water should return to the earth. But if we cover more and more of our world in concrete, this is what happens: runoff, where water doesn't drain. It just runs right over and down into storm drains. Now, the first thing we can do is a storm drain. It is a type of pervious ground cover, and it actually does a pretty good job. But the problem is all that water still isn't returning to the earth. Instead, it runs out into the sea where we don't harness it. And to the point about equilibrium, what happens when we lose water all summer and we're not putting it back? Eventually, the water level just continues to fall, and eventually the end result is desertification. And this is San Diego. We don't want to see that happen. So what can we do? In the case of water, unfortunately, it's a bit of an unstable equilibrium. And what I mean by that is, picture a rock on the top of a hill versus a rock on the bottom of a valley. On the top of a hill, if you don't move it, it could be in equilibrium and steady. But any disturbance in either direction will cause that rock to run away and go further and further and further down the valley. In contrast, a stable equilibrium would be a rock in the valley. Either way you push it, it'll return to a level state. So as we run off more water, it poses two problems. First, we're not capturing that water back, but the second problem is that the soil becomes hardened as the sun beats down on it, and that top layer of clay soils and other types of ground cover will almost become like concrete, where it gets harder and harder. If you've ever seen deserts that have scars with cracks that have formed from loss of moisture in the soil, that kills vegetation, it kills plants and trees that dig roots to kind of mix up the soil, hardens it out, and it makes it even harder for water to seep back in. As a result, it just sits on top and eventually floods away and doesn't return to the earth. So that is why water management is central to good urban planning, because without it, we'll eventually run further and further into debt and lose our water supply under us. But it's not so simple.
First, a quick word from our sponsor. Bespoke Post is a monthly membership club delivering awesome boxes of top shelf goods from under the radar brands. Become a member, sign up, take a preference quiz, and you'll get an email with your tailored pick each month. You can customize your box, switch things up, or skip on a lineup of new boxes each month. Like this, the Crackle Box with everything you need to make s'mores outside. Obviously a huge hit with my kids and was central to our family bonding time this weekend. The quality of the graham crackers, chocolate, and marshmallows were fantastic. Or this, the concentrate set that's perfect for cold brew coffee, just the afternoon pick-me-up for our team for those little bursts of energy. With high-quality glass construction and a reusable mesh filter, there's no waste, just great taste. And the concrete desk set is a work of art. Or the Hawker traditional Thai moon knife and curry kit. How cool is this? Based on centuries of artisanal Thai culinary tradition, the moon knife's unique rounded shape allows for a longer cut and an effortless back and forth rocking motion. We use all sorts of services for TV shows and music discovery, and Bespoke Post is our discovery service for amazing high-quality products, 90% of which come from small brands, many right here in the U.S. Each box of awesome has around $70 of value, but you only pay a fraction of the price. To get 20% off your first box of awesome, click the link in the description and enter TBDV20 at checkout, or go to bespokepost.com/TBDV20. Huge thanks to Bespoke Post and you for supporting the show.
Okay, this is your typical concrete and asphalt. It is made to be waterproof, as you can see from these puddles. And obviously, standing water is bad for a lot of things. Mold, bacteria, mosquitoes, and everything else. So the idea behind a porous or thirsty concrete is the opposite of this. Imagine you can have the strength and stability of a concrete foundation without this water-retaining component.
Here's how thirsty concrete works. Traditional concrete is made up of four ingredients: cement, the binding agent that holds it all together, rocks, sand, and water.
If you get up close and look at this, you'll see it's very, very tight, and that's because the rocks are porous. There's a lot of gaps and voids, but the sand fills that in. So to get water to actually seep through, just get rid of the sand.
Thirsty concrete can drain between 80 and 720 liters per minute of water per square meter, which is so impressive that it can almost feel like an optical illusion. We've grown accustomed to concrete being so waterproof for so long. In fact, when I watched those YouTube videos that went viral on thirsty concrete about 7 years ago, my first thought was, this is a trick. Like, how does this work? Because it just feels wrong. So unlike many of the ultra high tech solutions we cover here on this channel that cost way more money than the traditional approach, this is actually pretty simple. Just concrete minus the sand and fillers.
There are a couple limitations to thirsty concrete. For one, it's not as strong. As you can imagine, the more voids you introduce, and thirsty concrete has around 30% voids, meaning the rocks, like the area in between, have voids that take up about 30% of their volume. And as a result, there's less surface area for that cement to bind to, and it's not as strong.
So for that reason, odds are you're gonna have to go with a thicker slab of thirsty concrete. Like if you wanted a 4-inch slab of pavement, you might need 6 or 7 or 8 inches of thirsty concrete. You still get the water benefits with a little bit more extra strength. Plus, in the future, you might even need some rebar or other reinforcing materials to really strengthen and give you that long-lasting finish. Now, to keep thirsty concrete working effectively, it also requires a little bit of maintenance and cleaning up, like street sweepers. Otherwise, loose debris and sand and dirt and dust will just fill in the top layers and hinder its ability to seep water through. So, to answer our original question, if this stuff is so great, why isn't it everywhere? Well, the answer is, it's a tool, not a solution. It would be like buying your spouse a brand new kitchen versus buying your spouse a table saw and a bunch of sheets of plywood. If we think of thirsty concrete as an end-all be-all, yeah, it's not gonna work. But as a tool, it has some really interesting potential for the future of urban design and development. Future roads built with thirsty concrete sitting atop stone aggregate reservoirs could absorb water and hold it below the road surface. This wouldn't just mitigate floods, but dramatically reduce the chances of hydroplaning, where your car's tires lose contact with the road when traveling fast enough to lift off the ground on a pocket of water. This is why we have deep grooves on road tires. It's not for dry conditions. In fact, grooves reduce the contact patch and reduce the grip on dry roads. But in wet roads and wet conditions, they can be a lifesaver, giving surface water channels to travel along while still making contact with the ground. These under-road reservoirs could slowly seep water back into the ground and also be built with overflows where excess water can drain out to storm drains or holding ponds. And if you're thinking this is just a pipe dream for warmer climates like San Diego, where it never reaches freezing temperatures, you're not alone. Most people I've talked to have all voiced concerns of freezing and thirsty concrete. And if you have any insights about this, please leave us comments below where we can all learn together. But generally speaking, water freezing on roads is a problem because water gets under areas with cracks. Then as the water freezes, it expands and has nowhere really else to go, so it places high levels of pressure on the road surface and results in breaking up of the concrete. Thirsty concrete with 20 to 30% void spaces might actually allow for enough of the collected water to expand when it freezes to move without adding the pressure on the road. The Minnesota Department of Transportation actually did a study over 3 years from 2008 to 2011 where they tested various forms of thirsty concrete. With severe winters, this is a great data point. Their goals were to test for stormwater management, freeze-thaw durability, traffic noise reduction, and general longevity. They poured different concrete cells instrumented with thermocouples, strain gauges, and watermark sensors to record the resulting performance. Not too surprisingly, the deflection or movement up and down was higher in the thirsty concrete than traditional concrete. But as long as the roads hold up, this isn't necessarily a bad thing. In fact, one pretty surprising result from the study is that thirsty concrete roads actually absorb more sound and are quieter. Thirsty concrete also is found to reduce the number of freeze-thaw cycles and generally held up about as well as traditional concrete. Thirsty concrete even reduces the subsurface temperatures in the summertime and increases the subsurface temperatures in the wintertime. Both good things. But it's not all good news. The study found that traditional street sweepers were largely ineffective, as they just agitated the surface dust further into the pores, reducing all the benefits of thirsty concrete. They found that vacuuming the roads twice a year resulted in the best performance. And this maintenance needs to happen soon after the construction to prevent irreversible clogging. So now, on top of everything else municipalities have to do, they need to pull out their Dysons and vacuum their roads twice a year. The makeup of the road layer is as follows: a 7-inch thick layer of pervious concrete, 4 inches of railroad ballast rock, and finally 8 inches of a gap graded base. This is construction aggregate 1-5, made up of a mixture of rocks 2 to 4 inches in size, and size 5 rocks, which are about 1 inch or less in size. After 3 years, there was some surface cracks along the path of tire travel in cell 89 that was pervious concrete on top of clay soil. And again, this is a possible problem for thirsty concrete because, as you mentioned, the bond between the rocks without the sand aggregate in between is reduced. Further testing will be required to figure out exactly what causes this and how best to remediate it. But the biggest issue this research found is how uneven the drainage rates were for different parts of the thirsty concrete. This is because if building a traditional road is like building a mass-produced economy car, at least currently, a thirsty road is more like a hand-built bespoke Rolls-Royce. Because there are so many variables in how large the rocks are when they come together, there's greater variability in the cement bonding and the resulting drainage and strength. This means that it's generally harder to get an even and reliable product that can withstand the test of time.
Now, while you do want water to seep into the ground wherever possible, there are some really key exceptions. Like, for example, this is a huge problem. You don't want pools of water saturating back into the ground near bridges, and the pilings and the footings for this bridge here are going to potentially be destabilized. So while yes, we do need to find areas where we want water to seep back into the ground, buildings and other critical infrastructure are not one of them.
Thirsty concrete is incredibly promising, but we'll need to start experimenting with it at smaller, less trafficked areas like the Minnesotans did to come up with better methodology for producing it. This is like anything in engineering and construction, and hopefully it does happen and this concept isn't abandoned. So now, looking back at that viral video from 7 years ago, it leaves me with as many questions as it does answers. What was the composition of the aggregate base? Was the amount of water used just enough to fill the stone reservoir below before completely filling it and overflowing? Was there actually a holistic drainage system in place to carry this water out to storage ponds? How much traffic did the road see? And what care was taken to maintain it and vacuum up surface dirt? Hopefully, after this video, you can see something like this with equal parts wonder and curiosity, and a healthy skepticism and appreciation for all the challenges that lie just under the surface. Now, if you're wondering what you can do personally to help with this where you live, how about rain capture off your roof? Check with your municipality if that's legal. I have heard from some viewers that it's illegal in some places. It's hard to explain, but it has to do with runoff and capturing water back into rivers and stuff. But for me, where I live on a hill, if we had a couple hundred gallons of rain capture, we could keep that water from running off and flooding Fashion Valley like we showed here earlier in the video. And then we could use that water to plant and irrigate our crops in the spring and summertime for a few months at least, reducing the burden of extra water that we would need to consume. The bottom line is, While we have taken great strides in water management, in building and urban development, we still have a long way to go. Storm drains are great for preventing floods, but can cause a runaway effect and drying out of topsoil. As we mentioned, all of life is in an equilibrium. In the case of water, if you pave more of the ground, that runoff means the water is not going back into the ground, and if we keep pumping water out, it's just a matter of time before these effects have prolonged impacts. More and more dry conditions mean less plants. Less plants means less roots that can kind of break up the dirt and increase the water saturation levels. It's a runaway effect. And this is literally why we make this channel. We love modern civilization. It's amazing. Roads to wherever you want to go, and cars, power plants, right? Homes and power delivery, batteries. But all this stuff has an impact on our environment. And the question really is, how do we get clever about handling it? And when it comes to water, thirsty concrete is super interesting, but clearly more needs to be done. We need to build a city where thirsty concrete is at the foundation of road design or parking lot development. But what if that road that we showed earlier was designed to flood? That way nothing else upstream of it does. That is a part of urban design. We need all this water to have a place to go. And like we've always talked about, it all comes down to the rate of things. Most light rains are fine, right? We have enough storm drain systems in place to handle light rains. But when you have a 3-day storm or multiple storms back to back to back, that can overload pretty much everything. That's where dams have to open doors to release water and all those other downstream effects. A lot of this stuff is systematic and holistic. It doesn't just get solved by one road or one trench or one reservoir. It takes a rethinking. And this is something I think is going to happen in the coming years, because at some point something's got to give. Water is becoming a scarce commodity, and we just got a free gift of trillions and trillions of tons of gallons of water, and we're literally sending it right back to the ocean. That doesn't feel very good. I think we can do better. We must do better. And I think we will. Thirsty concrete. Yes, not much has happened. It's been really quiet for 7 years, but I'm not ready to give up on it yet. I think it has a place in the future. So as more studies or more projects use it come out, we'll cover those in the future. All right. If you like this video, thank you so much. Don't forget to hit like, subscribe, comment, engage with us. We're here. Let us know what we can make next. And if you like this video, I think you like this one as well. Until next week, I'm Ricky, and this is Two Bit da Vinci.